you. Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate your support. And I just want to briefly talk about my program. The reason why I set this up is to run through my jury repertoire, which is our annual assessment. And we have about 30 minutes of music of contrasting genres. And so it should be a pretty short, comprehensive program. The first genre that I'll be performing for you is from the classical period. It's a Mozart sonata, one of his earliest sonatas, in D major, K284, and it's nicknamed the Durnit Sonata. And the reason why it has this nickname is kind of a funny story. Mozart was one of the first freelance composers, so it means he would publish works for different publishers and patrons and make money that way, so he was really kind of very free with his publishing rights and making money, or not as much money from that. But this particular sonata, he was trying to impress a patron called Durnitz. So he was writing, especially in the last movement, which I'm not playing, but it's one of the longest sonatas because of the last movement, a big set of variations. The second movement uses a polonaise and other dance rhythms, which was kind of unexpected for that time for his style. And then the first movement, just more complex, and figuration is a little bit more involved. So it was very impressive. He was trying to bring out that natural protege nature of his writing to the make it more overt, specifically to impress this guy and get some connections and hopefully a long-time investor in his pieces. So the typical style that we hear in Mozart is a little bit more of a bright touch. He would have been working on a lighter instrument earlier, much earlier forte piano than the modern instrument we have. So it was a much smaller soundboard, smaller sound, and brighter sound. So it's kind of the challenge, how do we replicate some of that flavor on the modern instrument? So I hope you can pick up on that. But we still have very vocal sense in the second movement, very much inspired by Bellini, bel canto singing. So still get that vocal orchestral sense in the second movement especially. Then I'd like to play a piece by Debussy written in 1905 from his book of Images, the first book of that, which is Images. And this is very much emphasis on the audience being able to attribute whatever imagery or visions or stories they'd like to the music. Very big influence on how to access different colors from the piano, and that's where the word impressionism comes along. There's a lot of correlations to painting like Monet, where you can kind of gaze at a painting and reflect meaning by yourself through the work. So some of the figures we hear, we can pick up meaning maybe just through the modes, like he uses pentatonics and whole tone scales, or just the register makes us think of different colors or images, especially sparkles on the water. The actual nickname is reflet dans l'eau, which is reflections in the water. So very much kind of that liquid sense, that sparkling of the sun, the movement of the water that I hope you can hear. And then with that said, there's a lot of flexibility for what other images and feelings this music arouses in you as the listener. And then I'd like to play a set of Chopin pieces. Chopin, it was lucky that he was being cared for by George Sand, who was a very famous 19th century writer, female writer, one of the most successful female writers of the time, because these were some of the very last pieces that he wrote, the two nocturnes from Opus 55. And he was very sick at that time, but George Sand gave him the inspiration, cared for him, nurtured him back to some health where he was able to write these pieces. And so just the general style is more nocturnal, more soothing. We have a lot of accompaniment figures with still a singing melody in the right hand. So a little bit similar to the second movement of the Mozart, but still very relaxing, very personal music, and perfect for this kind of intimate setting. And then we have Chopin Etude, Opus 25, number 12, the very last etude from the set of Opus 25 etudes that he wrote, which, when you break it down into the actual harmony, instead of all the arpeggios, it's got a pretty straightforward progression. like pop music, actually, and very beautiful. There are sections where it uses the parallel minors and then parallel majors. So the harmony itself is very soothing. On the surface, it might seem very convoluted, very just unnecessarily articulating with all the notes. But when you really break it down, it's one of the most accessible etudes that there is, in my opinion, and one of my favorites. So I hope you enjoyed that aspect, especially the last one. And as a whole, I hope you can get a sense of that contrast in styles, but also some similarities. And I will love to answer any questions afterwards and see you all at the reception. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks so much for coming, everyone.
That was great.
Really appreciate it. And I look forward to seeing you all at the reception. Courtesy of my wonderful parents, thank you for all your support and ongoing encouragement. Okay, take care.
All right. That's a wrap.
You get it, Steven?